Yeah, thank you for coming to our talk, which we have entitled Noobs in Game Design, How We Level Up, and thank you for those who are just watching us until the next talk. Today, we will be sharing with you our knowledge on game optimization and getting your game to run at its best, giving some programming tips, and how to organize your time for developing a game. Originally, we were going to talk about marketing, but we use a different sort of ad system now, so we decided to dump that. So, who are HCT? We are three guys, only two of us are here today, who live in Wynnum. We all went to JMC Academy in South Bank. Us three, we all had the same passion for games, and we wanted to make fun games that didn't really take themselves too seriously, as well as strive to be respected in the industry at the same time. Just a little bit about me. I am the lead artist, designer, and the music composer at HCT. Before game design, my background was particularly in music. I studied a Diploma of Music Technology at TAFE. Later on, decided game design was what I wanted to do. And I'll let Reece introduce himself.
Okay. There you go. And my name is Reece. I am also studied at JMC Academy along with James. No prior experience before heading to JMC Academy. I was a professional couch potato and professional gamer. And although I do delve in some of the 2D and 3D art, I am primarily the programmer and game designer at HCT Games.
Alright, so what have we been up to? In the past year, we've made five games. We've made five games, all of them so far just on the Android platform. We plan to get them on iOS as soon as we jump through a couple more hurdles with Apple's dev sign-up process. The games we have made, starting from the top left, are OMFG Shapes, Jack Bean the Stalkening, Hey, and Shoot High into the Stars, which was Reece's solo game, which I did the music for. And then recently, we released Viking and a Knight Fight Each Other, which is why we're here today. We couldn't really think of a name for that, so we thought we will talk about that in just 2 seconds.
We actually have some footage to show
you. Yep. By the way, all the games previously, these are all available for free on the Android store. If you would like to nab them up, please, and show support. You don't have to if you don't want to.
Shameless
advertising. All right. So before we go into Viking and a Knight Fight Each Other, I will just turn this down real quick.
You can just turn it off.
There we go. All right, so the origins. Reece and I first got the idea for this game during the 2015 Ludum Dare Game Jam. It was around December last year, I believe. For those of you who don't know what that is, Ludum Dare is an online 72-hour game jam. It's held at ludumdare.com. It's held, I think, three, four times a year, every 3 to 4 months. The theme is voted by the users, and then you got 72 hours to make a game, really. Go to that website. I think the next jam is in about 2 or 3 more months. For this particular game jam, the theme was growing. So from that, we got two ideas. The first one, Jack Bean the Stalkening, which is out on Android once again. This is an idea that obviously sprouted from Jack and the Beanstalk. Shameless pun in there. And then the second game we got was, what would you call this? Mr. and Mrs. Claus.
Yeah.
Just whipped up some things in ZBrush, one semi-drunken night. And I'll just show you some game footage. The game footage didn't make it into the slide, but I have some right here. All right. It will. Okay.
Wonderful time of the year. With the kids and everyone telling you be of good cheer. It's the most wonderful time of the year.
just the result of one night. Oops. Anyway. And oop. Bear with me. So yeah, we thought, all right, the theme's growing. It's close to Christmas time. How about a game where? Oop. Nope. Nope. Not too far.
Too far.
Oh.
Go back. Too far.
All right, we're starting again.
Hi.
Sorry, guys. Dude, next. And so yeah, theme was growing. Close to Christmas time, we thought, all right, how about a game where Santa and Mrs. Claus are obese and fight each other just to eat more chicken? So yeah, we after that, making that in such a short amount of time, we realized we had the blueprint for what could be a much more polished and refined game. And thus, A Viking and a Knight Fight Each Other was born. And we do actually have a gameplay footage for that, right after I've come to that.
Oh, what do we have here? Oh, this marvelous game here. Oh, this is A Viking and a Knight Fight Each Other. You're all your warriors around, crashing them into enemy buildings. Take down their fortresses, and watch out for those defenses being shot at last! Oh no, oh, you die and respawn again! Oh, you just keep rolling around, watch out! Oh, rushing over those minions, you squash them over your fun bellies! Oh, there you go, run out! Oh no, that hurts! Oh, you win! Oh, marvelous! What was the Viking tonight fight each other? Get away! Oh!
As we said, we don't want to take ourselves too seriously, but somehow earn respect on the way. And see if there's a way I can just go into this.
Ah.
That's all right. Today I'll be going into depth about optimization, and mainly for mobile, but these optimization tips and techniques can apply to all platforms. And oop, next. That's the last video, so I won't ever do that again, luckily. All right, but first of all, what is Viking and a Knight Fight Each Other? It's a local top-down multiplayer deathmatch siege game made for touchscreen devices. Each player must take down the other's stronghold with the help of their own armies to destroy their castle and win the game. Why local multiplayer? We were inspired by the old cocktail arcade machines, which for those of you that don't know, it's basically just a table with a TV that you look straight down on, one player at each side, joysticks at each side. And mobile phones are stigmatized usually as an antisocial devices, and we wanted to experiment with making them more social and get people's greasy fingers all over your phone. And all right, so talking about optimization, first of all, why do we optimize? We do it so they can run on as many systems as possible, and I'll thank you then. We test our games on a cheap handheld device. It's a Huawei Y635. Don't know if anyone's heard of that. It literally costs $90. 1 gigabyte of RAM. We thought if we can get this running on that, we can get it running on basically anything. That's what we benchmark on. Also, the game runs at a high frame per second, and it can decrease the size of the game. So if anyone here has ever put a game on the Google Play Store, there's a 100 megabyte limit. If your game's over 100 megabytes, you have to do some sort of batch. Some programming trickery, that's the professional word for it. If your game runs on more devices, obviously more people will be able to play your game. So there are more powerful devices out there, like the NVIDIA Shield tablet, the Samsung S7, but majority of smartphone owners are still using the old models. In Unity's Q1 report, it's called Games by the Numbers. They release it biannually, I think, via email. Android users are more kind of slow to upgrade to the next Android operating system, so they're stuck around 4.4.2, which is the Android operating system that we run on the Huawei YA635. Alright. Next one. Where's the game? Just trying to find out where I'm up to. Oh yeah. So most games, if not all games out there, optimize, even if they demand high-powered PCs. Some examples, some famous examples of optimizing are Spyro the Dragon on PS1. They had a system where 3D objects seen from a distance were rendered at a lower polygon count, so the PS1 was not overloaded with too high of a poly count. Another example of, or more recent example, is The Witcher 3. That's from The Witcher 3. This low poly bird here, it's seen from a distance, but there's reasons why that looks like that. It wasn't made by an amateur artist. I know it looks weird and sloppy, but there is a purpose for that, and it's entirely to increase performance. And I will go over that a little bit more later. Oh yeah, this is what Unity sends you. Just telling you, the majority of users that use Android KitKat. So, all right. So. All right, so first of all, I'll just quickly go over some mesh optimization for any 3D modelers who are out there. So there's a retopologizing process. What I have here, this is the base model for the knight, I believe. No, the Viking, you are right. For our game, he is 15,951 tries, which is not very necessary for a character, and if you want a game running well on a mobile, especially a cheap mobile, which we benchmark on, you want them at quite a few less tries. So I use Blender, but every 3D program has this sort of thing. This is the snap button. What I do, I make a new plane. I then make it so the vertices snap to the nearest, the closest face. And it's just like putting shrink wrap onto the mesh, basically. And just extrude the faces more and more, and put it on a mirror modifier just to save half the time, and you end up with this. And it's a knight, my bad. But yeah, he is 1,834 tries, which is a lot better optimized for our game. But Unity does have some inbuilt components and tools to help optimize your game at the last minute. It literally has some automation tools in the build settings. So once your game is complete and you're like, all right, it's time to make my game work, there are literally just boxes you tick and it does some of the work for you. There's also components you can use on assets once they're all imported into the Unity engine. So Unity has a level of detail component which does the same thing as I was talking about with Spyro, with rendering lower poly objects at a distance. You can set non-moving objects to static and sprite packing. Has all these amazing things, but we said no to all these and we decided to optimize manually because we weren't getting the results that we wanted from using those. Nothing was really being compacted enough. There were just too many draw calls and our poor little Huawei Y635 was just not keeping up. So by manually optimizing, we had a cleaner, more modular development cycle and less files for Reece to fiddle around with in Unity. All right. Bear with me. So, I've glossed over a lot of stuff. But yeah, still talking about mesh optimization. It is a necessity for modeling in general. When we make a 3D model, we sometimes like to go nuts and add tiny little details. When modeling, it's good to take into account whether your 3D model is what I like to describe as either a passive or active object in your game. Passive meaning it's part of the background scenery. The player does not interact with the object. Things like bushes, pebbles, leaves, trees, also objects that take up a small amount on the screen. In general, it's not really an object of interest. And what we class as an active object are things like the player, interactive objects, scenery, objects of interest like a item pickup or NPC's importance. So what kind of things do we take into consideration when making a passive object? There are two main things, poly count and texture size. It doesn't make much to convince a player that a rock is a rock or a bush in a bush is, and so on. This example here is from an artist named Slort. This is from a polycount.com thread. It's called Low Poly Sub 1000 Triangle Models. He's only used 345 tries for this character, which is ridiculously low. And he's made a strong silhouette, and he's proven that with a well-made texture, we have enough information for us to see this model and think, okay, this model is a Grim Reaper. So the amazing thing with game development is that we have the complete freedom to cheat, and in game development, cheating is your best friend. Here's just another example of a strong silhouette. So we got away with 1,800 tries. You can tell the silhouette, this guy's a Viking. So yes. So using textures to save polygons. So as I said, cheating is a game designer's best friend. So what are some ways we can cheat while convincing the player they're in a living, breathing world? First of all, I will cover the environments. But in our environment, in a Viking and a Knight fight each other, we have flora. If I was to 3D model each of these different types of flowers, bushes, reeds, lily pads, I think we also have in the game, not only would it take up a considerable amount of time when we want to just get our games and ideas out there as quickly as possible, but the poly count would go way, way up in our scene. So obviously we're not going to put one lily pad just in one spot. We want to use 100 or something, for example. So that's a lot more vertices for our GPU to handle, and thus increasing our chances of a bottleneck. So instead of modeling UV mapping, texturing each of these flora, I just made a plane. That's just two tries. Then I UV mapped it and made a plant texture. And I made a few different plant textures just to make the scene a bit more interesting and not just have one flower. And then I gave this to Reece, and he puts them in Unity, and he adds a script, which looks like this. Now, this makes the plane face towards the camera at all times, which convinces the player that there's a bush there, the bush is looking straight at him, they can't see the sides of the plane, and it's very convincing. That's all you have to do for games. As I said, games like The Witcher and all do it. I think I saw it in the latest Zelda trailer, they even used it. They had reeds that were on a plane that were just animated. So yeah, now we have this convincing flora and our scene looks more lush, and in the end, it probably only added about 100 tries to our scene. Yeah, man.
And the main reason why we use that script is because if you're on the ground and you're doing a first-person or third-person shooter game, you wouldn't really need to worry about adding that script because you're going to be seeing the model from the sides anyway. If you're using, like, say, for example, like a lot of games do with that, of the same technique, they put it in a cross, so it makes the bush almost seem like 3D from a distance.
Yeah, actually.
But when you're over the top, like our Viking game, you're going to see that cross. So it's always important to have the bushes always facing the camera, and that's why we use that script.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. As he was saying, in a 3D game, I believe this one here, I wanted it to look more bushy, so what I did, I actually got the plane, duplicated it about three times, and just rotated it on 45 degree angles, and then if the camera were to zoom around it, it would look 3D and would be convincing even in an environment which allows more open movement. Alright, there's that again. All right, so also following along with it being all in the texture, when I was modeling this Viking castle, I stopped and I thought, if I really needed to model each individual plank of wood on the walls, I decided against that, and instead I textured in the planks of wood, added some shading, got a pretty decent 3D effect. As you see here, this is just on a plane, just flat. And from far away, it looks 3D, it looks convincing. It's all you need. And the player is not going to go up to it and zoom around it and see that's a flat plane.
Can I ask a question on that?
Yeah, sure.
Did you use normal maps for
none?
No, we didn't. But you could always take it further with normal maps. Obviously, it's pop out more. But
I guess for your game, you didn't really find that as necessary.
Well, exactly. Mm. It also depends on what style you want. Like, for example, was it League of Legends? Like, they don't use too many normal maps on theirs. It's all very flat looking, but at the same time, their paintings have a lot of detail.
Yeah.
And for example, even look at Blizzard. the Blizzard style, they're all of them are hand-painted textures. Yeah. Sometimes they use normal mapping, sometimes they don't. They rely very heavily on just shading and lighting to make stuff pop out.
So, yeah, normal maps are basically doing just that, but saving you the time of adding in shadows and...
It's not even necessary in most cases.
Yeah, well, World of Warcraft...
Extra processing power to normal mapping.
Yeah, World of Warcraft, I believe, didn't use any normal maps at first. And there's actually a texture artist I'm going to reference later on. And it's a really, really good learning resource as well. That's all right? All right, so... as I said, the benefits are it saves you more time, it takes up less UV space, and they can be reused. These planks of wood here as well. This is just one plank of wood I modeled, just had to UV the one, and then duplicated it all around. So I just had to UV map and create just one plank. That was it. Saved me a lot of time, and you know, I just had to texture one plank in the end, and I can actually use that plank later on another model in the game if I felt like it. And then of course another example of cheating in a big game is the bird from Witcher 3. So, polygon saving, trimming the fat as I like to call it. Polygons that are hidden can be deleted on models to save space and increase performance. So parts of a mesh that are obstructed by other models in your scene or that are not in view of the camera, they can actually be removed without players knowing. So doing this is especially useful for models that will be reused in your scene. For example, in our game, we had this rock here. Now, this is just one model, and we could scale it up in our scene to look unique for every time it's used. We can make it bigger, smaller, stretch it, however we wanted. We thought if we use about 100 of these, there's going to be, you know, quite a few polygons taking up our scene. So what I did underneath the rock, I saw four there, and I was like, don't really need those. Delete those, and now it still looks like the same rock from the top. This can also be done with any 3D model. You just got to think about what polygons you don't need. For example, the inside of this knight's helmet isn't solid. And the reason why I did this is because you never see him without his helmet off. So yeah, just got in there, got all those nasty ones out. On the inside of his coat as well, it's just a plane basically. It's not solid is what I'm trying to say.
Another example of this is one I remember, but some of you may have seen this if you were playing Skyrim or other Bethesda games. Sometimes boulders would stick out of the edges and you could see under them and see their reverse normals. That's exactly what they tried to do. They, instead of having a whole round boulder, they trimmed the parts that you wouldn't see, but they accidentally left it a bit too high up so that you could see that they...
Yeah, you will notice it on cliff faces and stuff, as you were saying. another reason why, we could get around with saving more polygons and him never removing his helmet is we completely removed his head. And as I was saying, underneath the armor, his shirt actually, and underneath the gloves, I believe, and the, no, not the feet. The gloves and the shirt on the inside are just flat as well because he never takes your shirt off. It can be done to any mesh that is attached to a character, so anything from armor to clothing. I've seen it be used on attachments on mechs. So when you're modeling anything for your game, it's good practice to be mindful of any polygons that are really going to waste and trim the fat on the model, so to speak. Next, I'll be going over texture resolution versus screen resolution. All of our textures in a Viking and a knight fight each other. They're each hand-painted. Every single one of them. When I hand-paint the texture, I tend to get carried away with any tiny details here and there, and I have to stop myself and think, how big is the screen on the object? Yeah, it's definitely took up a lot of hours in the past. We kept in mind the screen resolution of 1920 by 1080, which we also do test on a Samsung Tab S, which 1920 by 1080 is the screen resolution. And we thought, how much detail can be seen on this particular texture? And if a lot of detail can be seen on this texture, do we need an extremely detailed texture for something like a tree? And because of... Wait, I'll just go next. So 1920 by 1080. Sorry about this, I got a bit too carried away. So yeah, this is the size of the texture, which was, I believe, 256 by 256, or 512 by 512, sorry, on the screen, takes up that. And here's the tree in our game. And I got to think, do I really want to spend an hour putting really nice looking bark on that, or whatever I want to do, painting a squirrel into it, if I even want to do that. So I ultimately decided that this texture does not need to be extremely detailed. A lot of the time on mobile devices, we can get away with crushing textures down to such a low resolution to the point where they will literally become a blur and the player won't notice unless they're really paying attention. There was one game which I was playing as I was making this that I wanted to point out. It's called Poco Echo. I played it on Android. I believe it's on iOS as well. If you pay attention to the trees, the stars in the sky, the rocks, the plants as well, the characters, his eyes, it's all just crushed down. They've been crushed down to such a low resolution that the textures become blurry. And we don't notice this. As long as there's enough information there in the texture for the player to recognize what those base features represent, despite the fact that, they're overly simplified. So, for example, the eyes, two dots, you can still tell that's two eyes. As I said, two dots make an eye, make eyes. You can also draw the player's eyes away from compressed textures by having a high resolution texture on something like the main character. Another example in Poco Echo. You'll notice how sharp his eyes are, especially back in this one. So how sharp he is compared to this character. So because your eye is so drawn to the main character, you don't notice just how low resolution the shadows are on the rocks here, how much the texture on the actual rock has been crushed down. Like, that's just a blurred color. Like, where can we use higher res textures? Another case where we had to use a higher res texture, we had to use the 1024 by 1024 texture for the credits on a mobile, which is very big. This is so we could just get people to see our names at the very start. If we put it any lower, it just turned too blurry. You couldn't really see what was going on. So pretty much objects or textures that take up the whole screen or objects of importance is a good time to use higher resolution textures. All right, so I'll be covering modular game textures. As we were making the game, we wanted to optimize from the get-go. So to do this with textures and keep as many draw calls down as possible, as well as give Reece and I the smallest headache possible, I made a 2048 by 2048 pixel canvas in GIMP, and I saved it as everything texture. Now, with a 2048 by 2048 canvas, I can easily fit four 1024 by 1024 textures, or 16 512 by 512 textures, or 64 256 by 256 textures, and so on. And when I make a model in Blender, UV unwrap it, I texture it, and it's all finished, I then drag and drop the texture into my everything canvas on GIMP, turn on snap it in place to the grid. I believe for the game I made everything 512 by 512, and I just add it. And this is, I believe, all the objects and the two main characters that we used in the game. Then I go into Blender. I select the UVs, and I know that the original size was 2048 by 2048. And the new size is now 512 by 512. So in the UV editor, I scale that down by 0.25 of the original size. I then use the snap to increment tool, which is down, I think I actually took a picture of that. Here we go. Snap to increment. And I snap it directly over its texture down to the exact pixel. So that slides out of order. And move it from there to there, and now we still got the same texture on it, and it's all part of one draw call now. After this, Reece makes one unlit cutout material in Unity and applies it to all the models that I give to him, and he applies this one texture to the material. Now, whenever I give him a new model with a new texture added to the almighty everything texture, he just drags it into Unity, applies the everything material, and he simply overrides the original everything.png file. So now we have a full scene with just one texture and one material, and we just rinse and repeat this process. It's fluid, it's fast, we're not managing too many files, and it's much, much less draw calls to keep our little Huawei Y635 happy. So, another way we attempted to reduce draw calls and increase performance is we put all the environment assets into one FBX file. To do this, I just opened up a new blend file, imported all the models, they were already UV unmapped, so I didn't have to worry about doing any of that. I organized and named all the objects. You see here, they're all named on the side. so it wasn't one big mess for Reece when he imported them. I then exported all these as one FBX file and gave it to Reece. He then it puts that into Unity. He then extracts each of these as their own prefab. And now we have an environment that's just one FBX and one texture. So, oops, and that's how we got it to run on our Huawei 365. Now, finally, I'll be going over organizing our time. Being a two-man team for this game, both of us working many hours a week and fitting in social lives as well as much-needed R&R, we don't have much time to put aside for game development. We need to organize our time and set weekly goals. So to do this, we use a website called Trello. Now, Trello is a website made to organize your progress and set daily, weekly, monthly goals for yourself and for your team. So Reece and I both use this, and it really helped us push this along. When you first open up to Trello.com, and you make an account, obviously, you click on the top left window, and you make a new board. We simply titled this one board, A Viking and a Knight Fight Each Other, Dev Week 1. This is where we will organize everything we're doing for the first week. When we click on this, we're asked to make a list. I made one here for myself called Viking Environment Models, just up here, and I clicked on Add a Card, which is right there. The cards inside of the list, they're used to create individual goals, and you'll see here I got, bushes, castle, Viking walls, Viking gate, Viking house, tree. And when I click on these cards, you know, I can add a color to show that the card is either being worked on, to show it's finished, show it needs being worked on, yellow to show it's currently in development. Then we set due dates for each model, like maybe I want to work on two models a day. So for the tree and bushes, I've put, 23rd of June at 12, just as an example. And so Reece can see this as well on the website. We click on create a team, which is this plus button, and create a personal team. It'll ask me to type in my name and take me to this page where I can find Reece's username, add members, add him, after he makes an account, of course. So now him and I can both share the boards and cards and set weekly tasks for ourselves and talk about Scrum meetings. Another thing as well, if you're using Google Chrome or Mozilla, there is an extension called Scrum for Trello, so you get live notifications from your board if someone finishes a task, adds a task, and so on, and you obviously click on that notification, it'll take you straight to the page. Just real quick, if you're interested in learning how to make stylized textures, as I was saying before, Blizzard artist Jamin Chalet worked on Warcraft 3, 2, also did World of Warcraft as well. He has a very good tutorial here to show you how to get everything out of the diffuse texture and not use normal maps or specular maps or anything like that. There's the link for that, the video title for that, if you guys are interested. But yes, that concludes my part of the talk. And on to Reece's time. Oh, sorry, I'll leave that up there real quick if anyone wants to write that down. But yes.
Any questions for James before we continue on?
No. Sweet. All right. Okay.
All right, guys.
Pass the microphone.
Oh.
All right, guys, I am going to go through a lot more technical tutorials with programming and how to use a lot of the Unity's inbuilt software and add-ons. But just to start off on a bit of a fun subject, I think I'd like to talk about a subject that's very close to my heart. I think I'm a bit of a freak for having this affection, but I love making main menus for games. I actually find myself spending a lot more time than I should on main menus. Sometimes I'll be working on a main level for the game, and I'll have an attitude of, oh yeah, that'll do. But at the same time, when I'm on the main menu, I come up with dozens of ideas. I have a huge attention to detail. And I think there's a reason for that. It's because I think that main menus can make a very big impression on your game. And the subject for that is interactive menus, and I'll explain what I mean by that. So is that one?
Or?
Yep. So a menu, let's start off with what is that? I think we all know what a main menu is. It's a visual presentation that displays all of your options, included to, not limited to, credits, audio, visuals, graphics, and the play button. And we all know what a menu is, so let's get on with it. But what's the first thing that a lot of people think of when they see a menu? Well, a series of tabs, buttons, and a very pretty background, and there you go, you got your menu, wow. So if it does the job, why put in the extra effort if it's just your main menu? It's not the main game. Why would you pay so much attention to it? Because of these abominations. You should really avoid menus like this for your app games, and there's a reason why I absolutely hate them. It's because they're plain, they're boring, and you could find hundreds, literally hundreds, of app games that follow this exact same formula when making a menu for their app game. It's not enthralling. As a result, I have a lack of interest when I see this game, and it's just a muddled mess. It's got the play button, fair enough. It's got all the things you need for it, but I just have no interest when I see this. I tend to avoid menus like these like the plague. So why is this such a big issue? Well, again, I think that app games have a very bad reputation when it comes to their main menus, especially when compared to their AAA counterparts. The main menu is the very first part of the main game that you see, so I think it's important that you start things off with a great impression. And I think that a menu can actually set the tone for your game. If your menu is boring, some people might think that your actual game is boring. So let's compare it to a AAA title, Dragon Age Inquisition. Follows the exact same formula for the last one. It just has the simple tabs, got the pretty background. The only thing that really makes it different is the graphics. But at the same time, you don't need graphics to make an awesome menu. It looks gorgeous. You have an interactive background. If you actually watch, it's not a video, but if you actually haven't seen any footage of it, you got the soldiers, they're marching off into the distance towards this temple, and when you press the play button, a big explosion happens. So it's a lot more interesting, and I get the theme that it's a war-based game, there's going to be a lot of combat and battle, so immediately I get the tone set for this game. But at the same time, when I said earlier about interactive menus, that's not what I meant. With interactive menus, I mean menus that you can actually play around with, like a game within the menu almost. So an example of this is Hearthstone. I'm not sure if any people are familiar with Hearthstone. It's a game made by Blizzard. It's a card game. And from the very moment you load into the main menu, you're given this. So you press the play button, cabinets open up, a lot of gears start turning, and you're bringing into a different menu. So immediately, it's already set a different tone to the previous menus that we saw, which just have a bunch of boring tabs, and you know, you click one tab, it leads to a different window. At the same time, this has a lot of different looking menus. It's got several animations playing, different audios. When you look at your cards, you get different pages that you can turn through. Already, I'm actually having a lot of fun playing this game because
Yeah, because it was that menu alone.
So you receive a feeling of immersion when you actually look at this menu. You've got a mechanical box that I could personally believe I am storing all of my cards in if this was a real physical thing. So it adds an immersion effect, still follows the exact same tabs and button formula of other menus, but at the same time, they've made it a lot more interactive. Another example of this is the menu for Dead Space 2. Doesn't do anything as fancy as the Hearthstone menu, but not sure if a lot of people notice, but when you go into the actual game, you can look off to the side of the screen, and you actually get this message here. And it's in the Unitologist text, sorry. But it is actually a little Easter egg. And you can actually spend time to translate that text, and it says a message. And when I first played this game and I saw that, I actually stopped to not play the game and find out what that meant. And I actually took time out of my day to do that, which I'm very ashamed of. But that's the point. It's not even the main game, and we already have an Easter egg. We already have a level of interactivity.
What was the message?
I think it says something like convergence is coming, like it's something very theme-based.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and I think another thing that I didn't write about is the more into the actual game you get, and if you save the game, you come back to it later, it adds extra markers to the menu. So it starts off with like just like that, but as you go into it, you get more objects in the menu as you delve deeper into the actual game, so it changes along with it. But same time, basic interactivity, but I've already had fun with it. And I can't actually think of too many AAA game titles that have followed that same formula of interactivity with their menus. As I said, you've got Hearthstone, you've got Dead Space, but at the same time, a lot of companies don't spend too much time on their menus because, as I said before, it's just the main menu, so why would you spend extra time on it? But when making the menu for a Viking and a knight fight each other, originally I was just going to do that. Oh dear, the video might be loading, dude.
No, that's all right.
Is that right? Okay, sweet. So originally it was just going to be a nice round video of gameplay in the middle like you saw before and then have tabs around the screen. Basic, gets the job done. And so why would I do that? Well, I decided to make the menu a bit more silly and more fun because, as James said, we make games that shouldn't be taken too seriously. It's not the personality of HCT games. We want everything to be fun, even the menu. And game designing is suffering. So have fun in any way you can, even if you can leech it out of the main menus. And here's the actual main menu here. So it starts off with our HCT title, comes through with curtains opening up, and then you get this. And believe it or not, these are the actual buttons here. So you have the play button, and you have the credits button. When you hit the credits down here, the curtains close, and the button is actually just a coaster. So it's not an obvious tab that you can press. You have to press around and explore. You press the play button, they start bickering over the hand that the knight is holding. Because then they start saying things like, I want that hand, give it here. And you actually see a hand trying to take that hand there. And if you press the cancel button, oh no. So at the same time, it's a level of interactivity. It's a lot more interesting. It immediately sets the tone for the game. Let's see. When you see this game, what is your first impression upon seeing it? Like, would you think this is a very serious game? No, you wouldn't. It's a bunch of fat warriors eating ham while ramming down buildings. If the menu showed a dark and gritty scene like a lot of AAA titles do, where they're kind of standing menacingly over each other, over the battlefield, and then you actually played the game, like, what would you think? Menus are the first things that we see in a game. It sets an important tone, and first impressions are important. And I think that personally can be made with a main menu. So, yeah, why not? Have a video showing in it. Make a game within the menu. While you're exploring and setting your settings, why not have things happen? Set jokes. Why not? And that's the end of that talk. I'm going to get into the actual nitty-gritty details of Unity now. And the first thing I'm going to talk about is the NavMesh system. Now, what is a NavMesh system? Well, it's actually the system you can use to make very basic artificial intelligence with pathfinding, patrolling systems. And I'm going to take you through how to do that first. So in this, I made a very simple scene, just out a bunch of cubes to make a ramp and a ground and a little high ledge over there. And this capsule is going to be our AI unit. And just so you know, in Unity, AI is referred to as an agent. So when you hear the term agent, that's what I'm talking about. I just mean AI. So if you go over to the right-hand side of the Unity screen where you usually have your inspector, you have the navigation tab. And this is where we're going to be doing absolutely everything. And you have three tabs, objects, bake, and areas. Now, you do have the option of completely missing the objects tab. It's not a compulsory thing. You can just skip it over to the bake settings, press bake. It'll absolutely do everything for you, but at the same time, it'll do things that you don't want it to do. So this allows you to have a bit more control. Now, you go over to your navigation, you select your objects, and you can actually select the objects that you want to have navmeshed. And then you can give them filters like this, walkable, not walkable, and jump. Now obviously, walkable, if you label something as walkable, it will be labeled for navmeshing. Not walkable, it'll be completely ignored. I never understood what jumping is for because it actually has nothing to do with jumping. So, I think it's actually just to show you what we can do in the areas tab, but just so you know, we're going to be completely ignoring that. Agents can jump down ledges, but they can't actually jump up without any programming trickery. And this is what you get when you click on the walkable. So you get this nice blue nav mesh, and yeah, it basically bakes over everything that we've selected. You receive a flat blue surface over the mesh, and that is exactly what the agent will be using to travel. Its destination is this cube, and every time the cube moves, it updates the position that it wants to go to, and it traces almost a line over the mesh and say, okay, I want to reach this point. I'm going to start tracing the path over that mesh, but it will never go off the mesh. So if we press the bake settings, why do we have this green border along here, and why didn't this part get nav meshed? Well, we'll go through all of that later. And this part here was labeled not walkable. So I put a cube in the middle. It was all one flat surface. It could have easily been nav meshed over, but I labeled this cube in the middle not walkable. And as a result, the nav mesh actually baked around it to give us this solid hole. And again, the agent will completely avoid that. It'll just go around it and stay clear of that area. And that'll be useful for buildings. It could be useful for lakes. Basically anything that you don't want the agent to walk over. And a couple of notes on that. So say we had that solid sphere, we had this solid nav mesh here. We could put a sphere in the middle, label it not walkable, rebake the thing, and it will bake a hole around that boulder. So you can continuously add things as obstacles and just update it, and it will automatically do it for you. But one thing
Sorry, just for clarity. So you're saying you mark the sphere as not walkable, even though the entire plane is walkable. And
yep.
Cut a hole out of the plane.
Yeah, essentially. Yeah, it essentially becomes a cookie cutter. Essentially, like it's everything there you see that is blue nav meshed is walkable. That cube that we previously labeled not walkable, I've made that into walkable again, and it should have made one solid nav mesh like we originally saw. But because that sphere is cutting through it, it'll say no, that's an obstacle. I want to go around that. But one thing you do need to note is that this is a baking process and it doesn't automatically update the nav mesh if you move something. So we had this ledge over here. It was nav meshed, but let's say, oh, I don't like the position of where that ledge is. I want to move it. The nav mesh will not move with it. It will stay wherever it is baked. So if you move something, you have to rebake it. Not that it's a very long process. It's a very quick process. You just bake it, let it do its thing. Yeah. Now the actual bake settings are the settings that we are going to give the nav mesh so that the agents, the AI, will know where they can and cannot go based on their settings. So over here you have the agent radius. Now you remember that border that we have around the edges? Well, the radius actually determines how close an agent can get to a wall. So the larger the radius, the larger that border gets, the larger that gap becomes. The agent height is how low a ledge that the agent can go under. So say, for example, you had that ramp there, and we'll get to that. So you've got this ramp here for the agent height. The agent's height was set to very high, so as a result, it'll say, look, I'm too tall to go under there. I'm not even going to bother nav meshing that area, just in case. So now, the agent will know that it cannot walk there. It'll just go around the ramp. But in this window here, it's set to very short. So it's essentially saying, look, you have short characters, you have short agents. I'm going to nav mesh this area so that they can get under the ramp if they choose. Step height. When you nav mesh the area, the step height is essentially going to say, how high can I go through obstacles? So this is a picture that was set from the Unity website, and it's a series of steps. If I chose to completely ignore the step height, it would bake each individual step. And it would still go through that just fine. It doesn't need one solid plane to actually get up the stairs. But if it was doing that, it would be very jittery. It won't be one smooth movement. It'll go bump, 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 bump. So if you set the step height, it'll actually cut through that, and the agent will just follow that in one smooth nav mesh. It won't even be bothered by that. I actually found that the step height, remember when I said that you can't actually jump using the using nav mesh because you can't jump up, you can only go down? I actually find that one little cheat that you can do is setting the step height really high up. It will connect like that previous high ledge that we saw before. It'll create a nav mesh ramp up there. It'll look ugly. It won't be a very smooth movement, but it'll get them up there. And off mesh generators. And this is the drop height. So say, for example, we have that ledge here. You can actually set a drop height. As long as that thing is perfectly set vertical, you can create a ledge that the agent can go off mesh onto a different mesh. So it doesn't need to be one solid thing. It can actually go off the mesh so long as you have a link there. If you had that ledge there and there was no link, it would stay forever trapped there. It wouldn't be able to get on there. And again, as you saw there, it could jump down and the arrows are pointing down, but as soon as its destination was set up there, you couldn't find any way to get up there because, again, you can't jump up. And you can actually do the exact same thing for jumping across. Exact same settings, you set a distance, it'll create a bridge between the different meshes, but unlike drop height, it can go both ways. It's not set to the same limits of jumping up, so long as it's set perfectly horizontal to each other, you can actually go both ways. And you can set that setting to be as far as you want. But yeah, obviously it'll look a bit silly if you have that thing going straight all the way across there. And then you have some advanced settings. I tend to completely ignore these because there's just really no need to adjust these, but same time I'll walk you through them. Voxel size allows you to change the accuracy of the nav mesh. Again, I've completely ignore these because it's usually a very accurate nav mesh when I bake it. But at the same time, if you want to make it less accurate because you want to save time on the baking process, you can do that just by reducing the number. The minimum region is a very useful tool that I sometimes use. It culls an area that is below the number. So let's say if you did a nav mesh and you found these little patches. The little patches just like on top of buildings that you didn't want because you just missed them during the baking process. And they're just these little tiny blue dots. You're not going to use them. The agents are going to ignore them. But at the same time, if you leave them in your game, it takes up extra space. It takes up extra processing power. So you set a minimum region, and any nav mesh that is below that region will just get deleted once you build the game. And the height mesh stores the static mesh internally and extracts a Y position of the nav meshes. I've never needed this system. I wouldn't even know what to do with it. But if anyone here does know, please let me know. And the areas. The areas for the nav mesh is a lot like tags or layers for your assets. It allows you to set the color for those nav meshes. So you see we've got the standard blue that we saw before for the walkable area. But it allows you to create your own areas and give them their own colors. That might be for your own personal reference. So you say, look, you got path number one. I want that to be the blue path. Path number two, I'll make that a green one. And yeah, you could just use that for your own reference. But this is the important thing over here, is the cost. And what the cost is essentially is what priority the agent will use to take that path. If it's a high cost, it will not be selected if a low cost path is set nearby. So let's say, for example, this alternative path here with a cost 3 was right next to a cost 1. It will take the cost 1. It will completely ignore that, even though it might be a longer path. This one is the closest. It'll take that path.
But if the one cost is much longer, there's a point where it's
Oh, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. It does take that into account as well, yeah. But at the same time, if the difference is not that much, it'll just take the low cost one.
Do you know if all this is working over 3D terrain?
Oh, yeah, it'll work perfectly over 3D terrain. Like, even though I set the scene to be like completely flat with cubes and stuff, you could use that to use the 3D terrain editor. Say you've got a nice big sculpting of beautiful mountains and all that stuff, it'll mesh over that just fine. It won't go through every little nook and cranny, like say if you have like a little crack in the side of a hill or something, it'll just go over that if it's necessary. If you set it to be just going over that, it'll ignore that crack instead of going inside of it and nav meshing it. And when you create a new layer, you just go back to the objects tab, and that walkable thing that we saw before, it comes up down there. And again, I'm really glossing over the details, but these are just the bare essentials that you need for nav mesh. Oh, yeah.
Did you have to do anything tricky for the flowers that he said he put into the terrain as texture?
Oh, just that that code that we attached to it.
Sorry, I meant more when you roll over it. I would normally expect a flower to be crushed.
You could set an animation for that, or like a box collider. So if your player goes through that, you could set a different set of textures to do that, but we didn't need to, no, it was an unnecessary detail. We could set it if the camera was closer, I suppose, but yeah, again, it was all part of the, if we don't need it, don't do it. Yeah.
I'll just add to that, we did do it with the trees, so as soon as you ran into the trees, I think they use a capsule collider, they suddenly... got a rigid body component attached to him, which then made him fall over, really.
Yeah, so you knocked over him, and then it'll just go, physics taken over.
Yeah.
Okay, I was expecting it might be something different in the pathfinding, but meh.
Oh, no, like the flowers and stuff, even though you can nav mesh over terrain, you can choose to completely ignore the flowers, they'll just be there.
Okay.
But now we're going to go over the agent settings. Now, you'll notice a lot of the same details here. We've got radius, we've got height. If we did that before in the bake settings, why do we need to adjust these? Because the bake settings just affect what potential paths you could take, while the agent settings adjust whether or not they will take that path or not. So say, for example, you've got the radius here. You might have a very big character who can't get very close to walls like a small character could, and that also adds into height. Even though that ramp that we saw before has a potential path for shorter units and they could get under that one, A character with a very large height won't be able to take that ramp. It'll try to take that ramp, but it won't be able to get under there. And because again, if you just had a, you need to adjust these settings and make sure that they match the size of your character. Because if your character was a big giant, but you forgot to set the settings, and as a result, it's got a very small agent collider radius and height, and it sees a path. Oh, here's a very small little tunnel I can take, and then you see a big giant walking through the wall, then that's because of those settings, because although its agent can fit through it, the model should not be able to fit through it. The steering is how fast it can rotate. Big characters would usually have like a slower rotation speed if you want them to, because they're bigger and bulkier, they'll turn towards their destination a bit slower. Speed is their maximum speed. And angular speed goes into that account as well, because angular speed is how fast it can actually... angular speed. What's steering for? So yeah, angular speed is your rotation speed, sorry. Well, acceleration goes into your speed and it determines how fast it can reach that maximum speed. I usually tend to leave a little bit of acceleration because when your agent starts moving, it won't have its maximum speed unless you choose to give it that. It'll start off slow and then it'll slowly increase its speed until it reaches that maximum. But you can make it as fast of an acceleration as you want. If you want it to be a very fast-paced character, stopping distance is the distance it'll use to consider whether or not it's reached its destination or not. So say, for example, my destination here is that wall over there. If my stopping distance was zero, I would be completely face into the wall. But let's say if I set my stopping distance to be 5, even though my destination is the wall, I could stop here, and I would consider my destination reached. But that only works if the object is moving away from me. So say, for example, I'm trying to reach James, he's walking away. Even though he might be right in front of me, I'll consider my destination reached, and he's walking closer and closer towards me. Even though my stopping distance is set to reach that limit there, I won't move backwards. I'll only move forward to him until I've reached my destination distance. If he moves closer to me, I've still technically reached my distance. But if he's moving away and he's beyond that maximum stopping distance, I need to reach it. And auto-braking is whether it'll actually slow down before it reaches its target. With things like patrols, when they have multiple waypoints that they need to reach, it's always a good idea to turn off auto-braking because you don't always want them slowing down before they reach their point and then slow down, increase their speed, slow down, and continuously do that on and on and on. But again, I usually leave that setting on because I never see much of a problem with it. Obstacle avoidance is, wrong button, shit. Oh, there we are. The quality is how much care the agents will take when avoiding other obstacles. A high quality one, it'll completely avoid all the obstacles. But if it's a low quality, it'll walk through other agents. So agents, they're usually smart enough to avoid one another. If you set to a high quality and it has an agent right next to them, they'll be very buddy-buddy. They'll let others go in front of them. They'll let others go around them. But with low quality, they don't care. They'll go through one another. Their colliders don't matter to each other. I usually leave it to high quality. Again, I don't see much need to adjust it to low quality. And priority actually goes into that as well. It's actually a lot like the cost setting that we saw with areas. Let's see. So quality, priority. So the number indicates if the agent will actually move through the agents or not. If you have something that has a higher number than itself, it will consider it essentially a better agent. It'll go around it. But if it has a lower number, it'll just go right through it. And pathfinding settings, I tend to completely ignore those because you want it to be able to go off mesh to have those links that we saw before. If you turn that off, then it will not automatically traverse off mesh until you tell it to automatically, like through code, for example. Auto repath, you want to leave that on because you want it to be able to do automatic pathfinding. You want it to automatically reach its destination, and if it changes destination, you want it to take a different path. And area mask is where or not it'll actually avoid those areas that we saw before. So that alternative path that we saw before, it could completely ignore that if we wanted to. Now, each agent must have its own NavMesh agent component in order for it to actually work. And it still requires some programming to do. So even though you gave it a NavMesh, it still requires to have its own script. It still requires you to tell it where it's going to go. So we're going to go through that. It's all going to be done in C#, although it's very similar in JavaScript as well. Now, this line here is completely responsible for the NavMesh agent's movement. It's just two lines of script and two things up here, and that will make it move like we saw before towards its destination. So the NavMesh agent there, that's its actual component that we were just talking about, and its destination was the cube. So it gets the component for the NavMesh agent, and it sets its destination to the transform of the GameCube, and it'll automatically use the NavMesh to reach that destination. So again, here we see it before. This is the nav mesh using that and lean over there. So it's very quick and simple. I can go back and review the code for you if you like. If you want to write it down, I'll take photos. But this is just something that I got off Google. So it's a very easy thing to find. Not overly complicated, but that's a good thing. It's simple, so it allows you to get complicated. And we're going to show you how to do that by making a patrol route. So we're going to make it go and follow a waypoint system around this circle here. And in this scene, I've set the queues to be named P0, P1, P2, etc., all the way up to 5 and 6. And again, you see the original code that we had here, but we added in some extra parts. So we added in an onTrigger enter. And basically what it's going to do is say, every time I enter one of the cubes, I'm going to add one to a float. I'm going to use that float to find the name of my next destination. So say, for example, the float starts at 0. So its first destination will be game object find, letter P, plus 0. I want to find P0. That will be my destination. And then when I enter the cube, I will add 1 to that float. So now my destination is P1. And it'll keep going like that and that until it reaches P6. But we don't have a P6. Because we started at 0, it automatically finishes at P5. But it'll still add that 1 float. So we want to add a control to say if it reaches 6, we go back to 0. And it'll keep going in that circle. So see, it keeps going through the cubes. It keeps adding, reaches number 6, starts again. It'll keep doing this forever and ever and ever.
And you turned off that auto break toggle for this one. It looks like it's not sliding down.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, turn that off. Yeah. And that's actually a good point. Yeah. So you see, it's just one quick smooth movement. That's because the auto braking is off. If I turned it on, it would slow down until it's reached it. Speed up, accelerate, slow down, speed up, accelerate, slow down. And you might want that for your patrol point, but again, I usually want it to be quick and simple. So what we're going to do now is add even more complexity to it. We're going to make it, while this character is patrolling, we're going to add a player cube who can go in, be interrupting this guy's patrol, and then that guy will chase after him. So we're going to have the startings of a stealth game here. So exact same script, except we've now added in an extra on trigger enter, which will be the player. So as soon as the agent hits the collider of the player, it'll adjust a float variable and it'll change its path. So here we have the same destination thing that we saw before. If the float is set to 0, it'll follow that exact same patrol routine that we saw before, but if it equals 1, it'll prioritize its destination to be the player instead. So as a result, you got this, doing the exact same carotene that we saw before, patrolling around, doing the same thing that we saw before, adding 1 to its float variable, and starting again. But as soon as it hits that, it'll adjust its path, and as soon as it exits, it'll go back to what it was doing before. And again, this will just keep going and going. Oh no! And yeah, and this only took me probably 10-15 minutes to program all that. So it's very quick and easy to do. Again, you can have mesh over terrain and stuff. It'll follow the exact same properties, exact same physics. But yeah, any questions so far or?
I just have one question.
Yeah,
yeah. Quiet so far. The horizontal jumping.
Yep.
Is there a trigger that activates so that you can then tell it to start using perhaps apply force, change the animation and so on when it hits that point?
Yeah, and that's actually where those on those areas that we saw before, like say that jump thing, even though it may not have anything to do with it actually affecting its nav mesh, you could tell it, say the nav mesh will detect. Almost like detecting a layer from an asset, almost.
The nav mesh agent will say, right, I'm at a jump point now.
Oh, exactly, yeah. It'll say, like, okay, here's the walkable path, and it'll say, okay, I'm now on top of a jump mesh, while it's doing the jump, you could say if jump mesh equals true, play jump animation. Oh, exactly, yeah. So that's exactly where those areas come in handy. You don't just use them for the affecting what paths it takes, it can also be used for detection.
Have you done much of this in 2D?
2D, no, I have not, no.
I imagine what I'm looking at, I imagine it worked, but I'm just not sure.
It's a bit of a different process, but you could essentially model this all in 3D and then have a perspective so it looks like it's 2D.
That is true, yeah, you can do that because it still does follow a snap grid. So even though you might start your agent up from way up high, because you just forgot to like put his feet on the ground, it'll automatically snap to the mesh. I haven't experimented with it on a plane up where it would be vertical. Like, I don't think it'll be climbing up the walls or anything. Oh, if you do that, exactly, yeah. But again, if it stays horizontal, you should have no problems and just have the camera going over the top. But if you decided you wanted to have it all side on, like if you were starting a normal Unity 2D asset, I don't believe it would actually create a nav mesh on top of the wall where it would do a wall climb.
There are different plugins in the asset store, you can look for opportunity stuff.
No, exactly, yeah, because there are actually slope settings for the agents as well as to how steep of a hill it can climb, but it reaches a maximum. It won't go a full 90 degrees where it will go up. It'll do like that steep, but it won't go all the way up. And these are some extra little things that I like to add to the code. And this is what I use to actually control my animations with NavMesh. Again, you can use like areas and stuff to detect the jump and all that. But for your basic attack animations, walkings, your idles, I like to use things where it controls how fast you're going. So basically what this does, it'll just say, look, what's my old destination? What's my new destination? Compare those to how fast am I going? If my speed is above 0.1, obviously I'm moving, I'll play a walk cycle. If I'm not moving at all, I'll play an idle animation. And next we're going to talk about the Unity GUI. Fun stuff, pretty stuff on the screen. So basically, has anyone actually done GUI in any of the previous Unities? Which one did you use?
I was on like 3.5, like pretty old stuff. In fact, one of the games I used, the GUI had to be written entirely in Go.
You had to use Onion.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I did not envy you. No.
Monster.
Yep, exactly. For anyone who did early days of Unity 4 or before then, you will know the pains of GUI. It wasn't done as an actual component that you could just place in, drag and drop like it is now. You had to, as he says, you had to completely program it in. The amount of times I simply tried to make a score text on the screen, you finally get it on the position you want, then you press the play button. For some reason, it flies way off screen. And then you have to go through, put clamps on the thing just to keep it in the position you want. Simply, the amount of times I've been told, hey, Reece, guess what? You're doing GUI. Yay. It drove me insane. But now it's awesome. Because now all you have to do is just go up to the game object component, go to UI, and you have all these beautiful things that you can do here. You have your texts. So again, if I wanted to make a scoreboard, I don't have to do any of that silly crap that we saw before. I can just go straight to it, make a text or an image or a button or a slider. Basically, it'll cover, if not all aspects of GUI, it'll cover most aspects of GUI. Now, when you do make any form of GUI, it'll come up with a canvas. And your canvas is essentially a what your camera will see in terms of the GUI. So even though we're in a 3D environment here, and this canvas is 2D, it's essentially saying, look, this is what your camera sees. This is where the GUI is going to be on your camera when you play the game. So say, for example, there's the button on the bottom of the canvas, and this is where we see it on the camera. And you don't have to keep it inside the canvas. It can go, absolutely, it can go outside if you want, but your camera will not be able to see it. And you can, it even acts as a 3D object. You can rotate, you can scale the GUI, but again, because it's a 2D thing, it'll end up a little bit squished if you rotate it around. Now, we're going to go through the actual canvas settings, and they're actually really good because they're very flexible. You can get many different effects with the canvas. But one thing you do need to note is this thing here, the render mode. You have many different settings. You have, we're going to go through all these first. So here you have your canvas render settings. You have overlay, screen space, and world space. And here you have three very different effects of what you can do. So overlay is the setting that we saw before. And it's a 2D scene. No matter where the canvas is in the actual game world, your camera will still see it. So yeah, even though my camera was moving side to side over here, and the canvas was not moving, it still rendered all the buttons in the exact same position, and it acts like normal GUI. Screen space is similar, but very different. It actually moves with the camera as if it was a filter. And the way that it varies is objects can get actually in between the GUI and the camera. So say, for example, if we were to drop cubes down in that one, it wouldn't actually see it. It would go behind the GUI because it's more of a filter rather than an in-game item. Well, with this one, it can actually go over your GUI. So you may want that effect, you may not want that effect, but do keep in mind if you have it like this at an angle like I do, and you have it getting closer to the ground, your GUI will go through the ground and you'll lose sight of it. World space, very different effect. It acts like an actual in-game 3D object that your camera can actually go around. So as you can see, you've got like, it's staying there, it's covering the cubes, and you have like this kind of panning effect with the GUI, and it can go off screen. You can place it anywhere in the screen world and you can go over to it. I actually found this quite useful for NPC characters, like if you had speech bubbles over their heads, but you want it to go over their heads and you want it to stay where it is. Other than that, I haven't thought of too many uses for it. I actually am using it in the game jam game we're using at the moment. I used world space because I actually wanted the GUI to stay over each individual character, like an arrow pointing to their heads.
You could also use it as interactable objects in scenes, so
yeah.
A character to press a button or something maybe.
But yeah, again, it all completely depends on what effect you're looking for. And you don't even need to stay with the one. You can put in as many canvases as you want. So say, for example, I want a heads-up display where I want my health to stay up here. I would use the overlay screen. And then I want NPC buttons. I'll use the world space canvas. So you can have as many as you want and have different varying effects. Now, this one is extremely important, the canvas scaler. The scale mode is how the canvas will scale if the screen size changes. You have three different settings. Constant pixel size is the default one that Unity places the canvas in. And although the canvas scales in exactly the same way the Unity screen is going, it will not keep the GUI in place, and I'll show you that later. Scale size with screen is the one that I would recommend, because no matter what size or resolution the screen is, it'll keep the GUI in place as if it was as it is now. And the reason why this is so important with these two here is I actually found out, even though I built it originally with constant pixel size in the Unity screen, and say, for example, I wanted it to all stay here, this is the size of the Unity screen. And when I put it on my tablet, which has a bit of a longer horizon on it, it's a little bit skinnier, it actually moved the GUI to a different position because it has a different resolution. Constant pixel size uses physical units such as millimeters or points, but it actually relies on the device reporting its screen DPI correctly. So again, I would not recommend that. I'd stay with scale with screen size. And this is what I mean by with constant pixel size. So here originally we see the picture here. This is the resolution I wanted. I'm happy with where the button is. But you know what? I want to take a closer look at the in-game scene. So I made the tab bigger. And as a result, the button moved. if I kept it in constant screen size, even though I made that screen bigger, that button would have stayed there and it would have made the button bigger. So yeah, keep that in mind. And now we're going to make a button. So again, this still requires some scripting, but nothing in depth at all, really. But first, let's go through the components. You've got the image component, which allows you to adjust what the image is for the button. And each button actually comes with its own text, like it has the text as a child of the button where you can type in it if you choose. But yeah, that allows you to adjust the image. The button settings here, very interesting, interactable. You want to leave that on if you're making a button that you want to interact with, because if you turn that off, it's no longer a button. You can't press it. So make sure that's on. But you can actually have a little bit of fun with the transitions, because with the transitions, you have all sorts of little effects here. You've got color tint, you've got sprite swap, or you can play an animation. With color tint, very straightforward. As soon as I press the button, it'll turn into the pressed color here. So it'll go a darker tone of gray. If it's not interactable, it'll choose the disabled color. If it's a normal color over here, yeah, you can actually adjust how dark or how light it goes when you press the button. Sprite swap, it'll change the image that you have it to originally. So say it's like it's a big green button and you press the button, you could have it light up and have an image shown in the middle. And then it'll go back to its original image. And animation, it's pretty straightforward. It'll play a sprite animation when you press it. And they all have the exact same variables. Each of them will have a highlighted aspect. They'll have a pressed aspect, a disabled aspect, and yeah. But this is the code that we're going to use. We're going to have the button spawn a cube. Pretty straightforward, and it'll show you how to access that code through the button. I have this code just attached to the main camera. And to the main camera, I have an empty game object, which will be the position where the cube spawn. So it'll create a cube. It'll instantiate it from our resources folder, which is in the prefabs. You go to your inspector, you create a resources folder. And when you load that, it'll create an asset directly from that folder. And then I want it to go to the position of that empty game object, which I named spawner. And essentially what I want this to do is I press the button, it'll play this void, and I should get a cube. So you go over to the very bottom of the GUI component that we saw before, and you get this on click. And this is essentially saying, when I press the button, what do I want it to do, or how many things do I want it to do? I press the plus, and I get this. And I can have as many of these as I want. But essentially, I'm going to drag the main camera with the script on it into this tab. And it'll allow me to actually access the script, which I named GUI. And it'll allow me to view all of the things I can do with that script, including the void that I written up, the bit of script. I named that script spawn cube object. I made it a public one so I could access it. And essentially, what it's going to do is say, you press the button, I'm going to play that void. And this is what happens. You press the button, it does a transition, and it'll spawn the cubes for me. And then I go a bit crazy. And yeah, that's exactly how easy it is. With buttons, again, I could have as many things as I want. I could have it spawn a cube, but at the same time, I might want it to open a door for me, or I could have it have the cubes jump up when I press the button. You can do as many things as you want with it. But let's make a game out of it now. So we know how to make a button. It's pretty straightforward, very easy, very fun. I suggest you play around with it. But now we're going to add points using the good old-fashioned GUI text that we said was a pain earlier. So we're going to make a scoreboard. So again, you go up to Game Tabs, UI, and you make a text object. But at the same time, I'm going to create a hoop. So a very standard hoop, just made out of cubes, and at the very bottom of the hole, I have a collider, which I've tagged hoop, and it's going to be a trigger. What I'm going to do is I'm going to spawn the cubes, have it go through the hoop, and I'm going to have some points. And at the same time, the hoop is going to rotate. Basically, it just has a transform rotate as an update, so it'll continuously spin around. So what we need is two scripts. We need one for the actual scoreboard, and we need one for the cubes. One for the cubes, that's there's for the scoreboard. So the cube prefab that we mentioned earlier, it'll have its own script on it. And essentially what it's saying is, when I hit the tag hoop, I'm going to look for the scoreboard, and I'm going to say, could you please play this void, add points. And we'll do that after 0 seconds. So the cube will only do that after it hits a collider. If it doesn't hit the collider, it'll do nothing. And then in this area, we need a text thing to say, look, this is the component text. I'm going to adjust the actual text box, which is just where you type everything. I'm going to find the score, I'm going to update it. I'm going to turn that score into a string, which will then go straight to that text component. So essentially this is what it's doing. I spawn the cube using the button that we saw before. I get one of the cubes in. It adds 10 to that score number variable. It's taking that score number variable and it's turning it into actual text, because although we actually have the score number there, text can't actually use floats. They need a string variable instead of a number variable. So every time you intend on using a number, you have to turn it into a string. And it places it right into the text box. And yeah, and that's just as simple as that as well. All right, so already we have a bit of a basketball game going. So what if I wanted to add a health bar? All right, we'll just go do that. Again, go up to Game Object, UE tab, and I'm going to use a slider as my health bar. And I added some extra little barriers to the hoop, and these are going to be death cubes. If I hit that, I'm going to lose health. So the slider shares very similar properties to a button. I mean, you have the thing here where you can add extra components, drag things into them. But they also share different variables over here, like whether or not it's interactable, whether or not you want it to tint, and when it does tint, what do you want it to do? It shares a similar settings. You can choose to make it an animation, or you can make it a sprite swap. But these are the settings that we want to adjust over here, in the bottom here. These are the main parts. This is the direction, whether or not it'll go left to right or right to left when it reaches its full length. So let's say this is 0. If I want it left to right, it'll reach 0. This will be 100, or it's the complete opposite, right to left. Your minimum value is how low you want it to go, and your maximum value is how high you want it to go. And your value is what it's currently set on. So the bar is full, it is currently set to 100. And you can press the whole numbers thing to avoid decimal points, if you want it to just stay to 90 instead of 90.3. Now again, just like the scoreboard, we want the slider to have its own script. And it'll follow the exact same logic. It'll have the cube hit the collider, which we've added in a new one called death. It'll look for the health bar, which is the slider, we named it health. Tell it to play a script, much like we did with the text, and say minus health. Into the slider, again, exact same thing. We want it to access its slider component, and we want to adjust value. So we had this down here where it's currently set, value. That's going to be our total health, and that'll update with our float. And then it adjusts our health number, which we've set to deduct by 20 every time the cube hits the death collider. Oh, and I will take this opportunity to note as well, if you ever want to do scripting with the Unity UI, you need to add this line here. Whenever you write up a new script, that won't be there. You need to type that in yourself. It will not allow you to add a slider component. It will not allow you to add text component until you add it in that line. I don't know why it does that, but apparently it doesn't.
It needs that because otherwise they can't actually know about that code that makes the UI work.
Oh, okay, there you go.
Yeah. I learned something today.
Yeah, now I learned something. So yeah, and we haven't added anything to happen actually when you reach zero health. I've got a bit lazy there, but just pretend that we die. So this is what happens. Exact same thing, scoreboard, spawn cubes. I hit the red cube, but I lost health. So now we have a risky basketball game available on Google Play. And yeah, that'll just keep going and going until you either tell it to reach zero and yeah. And that's it for the GUI. There is obviously a lot more that you can do with GUI. As I said, you can add raw images. We actually used a fair bit of the GUI stuff to make the joysticks for our Viking game. It's a lot easier than it used to be, so please do not be afraid of GUI. I used to hate making GUI, now I absolutely love it. I used the GUI system to make the main menu for the Viking game. We've only just scratched the surface, so give it a go. But now we're going to talk about mechanism. And for those who don't know what mechanism is, mechanism, animating tool, uses a flow graph diagram. Essentially, it has its own tablet. It's actually different from animation. Animation allows you to record animations, while Animator, using mechanism, will manage those. So we're going to use a night guy over here that James made in Blender, and he exported all as an FBX with its own animations here. It has an idle angry and an idle flail. Now, when you create a FBX like that, it'll normally come with its own Animator component. So all you have to do is make an animator controller and drag it in. And you'll be presented with this, with the starting block for your animation. You take the animations from the FBX, you just drag and drop them into the grid, and it'll create this default, which you would usually leave as your idle, because it'll be the first animation that it plays upon entering the actual game. And these are your transition arrows, which saying essentially, once I finish this animation, I'll go and play this animation. And you can see that here. And because we create a back and forth transition, when one animation finishes, it'll just continuously keep playing the next one along. But now we're going to add parameters, and this allows us to control which animations we do and do not want to play. And we're just going to use a very simple integer value, but you can add a true or false bool, you can make it float by triggers or whatever. And this is your transition over here, which allows you to add in those conditions. So you click on the tablet that we saw before, it'll bring up this, and it'll allow you to add in your conditions. So here we made an integer called getAngry. We want it to equal 1 before it moves away from its idle. So essentially, this is what we're doing. Here's the idle. This transition arrow here, it needs to equal 1 before we can do that. And before we can go back, it needs to equal 0. And I'm just going to adjust those parameters over here manually by typing it in. So you see, I'm not touching it, and it's just continuously looping because it hasn't met that parameter. I turn it to 1, and now it's stuck looping on this one because it's not 0. Turn it to 0, and it goes back. And now we're going to add a button, because now we're going to make that button change that, not manually like we did now, but through scripting. So we made a script, getAngry. It'll look for its animator that we made before, the animation controller. We're going to tell it to set the integer that we wrote, getAngry, and we're going to turn it into 1. And then after 6 seconds, we're going to set it back to 0. And then we're just going to leave it. As soon as we press that button, it'll change it to 1. Yep. And then it'll just stay like that for 6 whole seconds before automatically going back. And yeah, and that's mechanism. Mechanism is extremely easy. It's very fun to use. Mechanism is easy. Actually doing the animations, not so easy. But again, we barely scratch the surface of what you can do. People, especially with major titles, they create whole flow graphs using mechanism with character controllers, with idles, jumps, jumping from ledges. It becomes this whole complex wave where you can also add layers to your mechanism thing. What I did there was absolutely nothing compared to what those people do.
This is everything we use for the game specifically.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So I'm done. And yeah, that's the end of the tutorial. Any questions? Yes.
I've got a question about the menus that you love them so much.
Yep.
Did you ever consider when making the menu for the Knights and Viking game, having it similar to the controls in game, like with menu X and I think Fruit Ninja and stuff.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Love it.
You could actually have a guy rolling around onto menu options.
Alright, well, there's got to be an update tonight.
Alright.
It just seems like if two people are controlling it, it might make it easier that they're familiar with the controls before starting.
That's good.
Yeah.
Alright.
Well, alright.
Join HCT. Give us some ideas.
It's free. Free for us.
Any other questions at all, guys? Optimization or programming or anything like that?
We'll be hanging around for a few minutes anyway if you want to ask anything. Yeah.
Give us a high five or something. So.
Anyway, that's cool. All we wanted to show you. We hope it gives you some motivation to delve deeper into Unity systems. Like I know you said like you're good with programming, but you don't know too much about the actual how to integrate it all. But it's extremely easy these days. Like it's not the big mountain that Unity used to be. It's a lot easier now. So.
Okay.
Cool. All right. Thanks, guys.
Sweet. Thank you.